Welcome to the Fitness Plus Technology Podcast for club owners, operators, and fitness professionals. Each week, host Bryan O'Rourke brings you an expert interview with a global influencer at the crossroads of fitness and technology. You gain the insights, tools, and inspiration you need to stay connected to the pulse for what matters most for your business in the age of exponential technologies.
Hello, listeners, and welcome again to the Fitness Plus Technology Podcast. I am your host, Bryan O'Rourke. I hope your spring is going very well. And during IHRSA, if you were in San Diego back in March, and I hope you were, I did a main talk on five competitive dynamics in the industry space. You can find that on my SlideShare account, by the way. And I also did an open discussion kind of roundtable format where about 50 club owners showed up. The sound quality is probably not as great as it usually is, but you know, it's a very good back and forth from real world operators on tech, on anything they want to bring up to discuss it. And I found it a pretty great exchange, and I hope you agree. We promised that we would be releasing this. I wanted to wait a month and a half or so to let the show pass and let everyone get their feet back under them, because it's such a great show in San Diego. By the way, it'll be back there again next year, so I hope you attend in San Diego, the IHRSA Convention. So without further ado, let's hear some Q&A and back and forth with club owners about technology and all things fitness. So hello, everybody. Good morning. Thanks for being here. I'm recording this. I hope you're okay with that, because we're going to put it out on the podcast that I have after, so that if you want to reference it, so you'll see the presentation I did yesterday, and then the podcast will be about this conversation. And I'll have that all distributed up in the next few days in the presentation. By next week, we'll have it up at some point. So it'll make it easy on everybody. So we can do this a couple ways. I did a brief video last year, and then we did the talk. How many people attended the talk yesterday? Okay, good. So do you want to dive into that talk and really focus on what your questions are around that content? Would that be helpful? Would you like me to do a quick refresh? What is the consensus? Because this is about you guys, so go ahead.
A refresh
would be nice, just because I didn't see the talk yesterday.
Yeah, sure. We'll do it real quick. And let me show you real quick a quick video that you didn't see yesterday. That'll be kind of a quick intro. The light is not perfect here, but it's going to communicate, hey guys, a few topics that I think will be relevant, and then we'll get into some conversation. I think you get the idea. So let's go through the high points yesterday. It'll take me 3 or 4 minutes to go through this. First, we know we're going through tremendous global change driven by these dynamics. For every business is now a global business. I don't care if you have one studio in Hoboken, you can serve a customer in Hong Kong if you choose to. There's no limitation. So this gives a challenge for every company, no matter the industry. And it's, how do you compete with all those options? How do you compete? And it's these things we went through yesterday. First, the hard part is assessment, which is really having an objective review of what your current position is, your current capabilities are, and you're not kidding yourself. You don't want to kid yourself. Self-awareness about your business is key. We'll talk about the other ones coming up, mindset, user experience, economics, and execution. So we talked about assessment a little bit, what to measure, and understanding the right questions to ask. When you do assessment is hard. Asking great questions is now more valuable than the answers. It's knowing the right questions to ask. So the next four things are mindset. How do you see the world? What user experience, what brand are you trying to create? What economics are you truly operating under? And finally, the most important execution engines of your business. The mindset's gotta be based on the whys. You have to move from profit more and more to purpose.
hierarchies to networks, privacy to transparency, planning to experimentation, and controlling to empowering. Frictionless user experience, what you're seeing in the video, is key to user experience and brand design now. And that's basically, what are you delivering, when are you delivering it, and where are you delivering it? These three examples. And by the way, there's no right answer here. This is a series of deliberate choices that every business needs to be increasingly focused on to be able to compete. And we went through the various channels that are now available to everyone today. Everyone. You can be a single studio doing this kind of thing if you want to be. Not that you have to be. And differentiation is a key. I talk about Nike's recent Colin Kaepernick move, which we call the gangster marketing move of 2018 by brands. They did this for a very specific reason around their brand decision. Who is their customer? What is relevant to their customer? They made choices. Sometimes you're going to make people upset. You're not in the business of making everyone happy. You're in the business to compete. So it's important to make choices around UX. So user experience, outside first, based on the why and the brand, has to move to these dynamics. Personalization, frictionless, like I told you, strategic, and then finally, omnichannel. And omnichannel, by the way, is much more about today the in-club experience as it is the digital extensions of that experience. That's why you see design, as I went through yesterday, as being a more and more critical component of success. The bar's going up with respect to competing in that regard. We talked yesterday a little bit about economics, understanding benchmarking. It's not just about a P&L and a budget process. It's about really understanding the most important KPIs and data around your customers and users so you can take actionable, take action around that. And then finally, the execution engines. Automation, enterprise platforms, data collection, sensors, and the most important thing is human capital. What processes do you need to automate to enable you to deliver frictionless experience very well? How can you cut costs while you invest more in people at the right touch points that support your business model? Budget clubs, they don't want a lot of people, their models based on that, but they can do a high level of automation and create experience. Other clubs, they can compete by shifting more attention on human interaction at certain touch points. I use the Four Seasons Hotel in New York as a big example. I go there, you know, I can check in with my app, but when I deal with a human being, I can order room service with my tablet. When I deal with a human being, very high touch, highly trained, well-paid person. You look at SoulCycle and what they did. SoulCycle's been the guru brand in the industry in the last probably 7 years. High touch points, very highly paid instructors, high automation of booking, et cetera. These are decisions every business has to get behind and think about to be able to execute competition. And the future is going to be based on companies, no matter how big they are or small, because you can be small and crush it on fluidity, agility. You have to set this up so where you can be able to respond in a way that is easier to do than being rigid. And that's all about your mindset. So, the big question, and you know, this is going to be an open kind of conversation, is how do you do this? And as I said yesterday, one of the challenges to talk about this is every business is different. Every business is at a different stage here. So I want to pass the mic out and just have people tell us who you are, bring up a question, let's have a conversation. Who wants to start? No hands. Yes, here, let me bring this mic. Thanks for doing that. Chantel, where are you from?
I'm from Bellevue, Washington, just outside of Seattle.
Tell us about your business.
So I work for a member-owned club. So we have 262, most random number ever I know, member families. But we are only swim and tennis, so I don't have any fitness level of what we do. But a big threat that we have is that I have an aging membership population. So I have about half of my members that are all over the age of 55. And then I have a lot of young families coming in, bringing their kids in to start learning tennis and swim. So I have some members that do not want to change. They want to call in only to make reservations or get into a class. And then I have young members that say, why do I have to call in? It's so archaic. Like, can I do every single thing online? I don't want to talk to a person. So for us, that's a major threat. So I guess I'm kind of curious what other people maybe do to merge those two so that everyone is being serviced.
That challenge, we saw those challenges with Spectrum Club in the Texas market that we advised. And we, you know, it was a larger scale, but we identified the same problem. And our advice then was to sell their company. You know, I'm not saying that would apply to you, but our advice was to sell the company, because when we did analysis on what that would take to re-engineer, it was not worth it, because they could get enough money now to justify investment and move on and do something else. So in the as I touched on yesterday, there is one thing we have to identify an assessment, which is, where are you on your product business lifecycle? Because sometimes, as I showed you, the challenges go up, and to a point, depending on your risk profile, you have to keep in mind that exit is a very real possibility. Go ahead.
We're told
that
we'll have to be over your wait list right now.
Oh, that's good. Okay, good. So really what you're talking about is what customers you want to focus on, right? So have you done an analysis on taking pricing up on your existing base of older or more mature members?
Yes, and in doing so, we will for sure lose them, because they are all at retirement age and on fixed income. Mm-hmm. So it's a matter of whether or not we want to lose members that have been there for 40 years to bring in new membership.
And what technology platforms do you use to operate?
We use nothing. I use four different things right now.
So we use a Paytrace system, we use court bookings, we use Active, Team Unify Online for our swim team, and then we just have our normal website where we push info out, but we actually just signed with Club Automation, so we're going to be moving to Club Automation. We're in the process right now, so in May we'll be online with them.
You think the young families have a higher propensity to spend than your older group?
People will spend all sorts of money on their kids.
So this is an overall business plan issue. It's not just technology related, but it's good you're moving to a more automated platform. It's a great example of enterprise. You've got to have enterprise platform. So that's good that you're doing that. From a marketing perspective, from a UX perspective, you can always create a digital approach and then just let people know in your content play that dial this number if you want to talk to a human being. And then also chatbots, because you'll see the propensity for people to interact, even if they're more mature. Chatbots are a very good way to give instant human interaction. It's automated. So I don't want to go down too far the rabbit hole. Anybody have any on this one question? Do you have anything you want to add?
I do. You said you're member owned?
Yes.
So you fall in what I call, it's the old country club category for golf, which are all going down. So I was a member of a country club on the board and the president, and I constantly was trying to educate the members of the need to move forward. And so I think your biggest challenge is going to be, your board educating them about the necessities of what you want to do to maintain and be viable. Because if you don't get buy-in, you can have the greatest plan in the world, and they'll shoot down.
The board is great. Like I mentioned, we're in Seattle, so they're all young tech people on the board right now. So I don't have any older members on the board, so they're all very much like, yeah, spend more money to get us, you know, into the next thing. We want video equipment. We want to be able to see ourselves play tennis. We want to see all of that stuff. So they're willing to spend the money. It's just, do I rip off the Band-Aid? Do you mean to go for all of it? Or do we slowly but surely integrate, you know, people in? So
that question is one that's about a risk return profile. You know, how much risk is acceptable? That's a business decision. Go ahead, Peter.
Sorry, just to stay on the same subject. I mean, you mentioned you have a waiting list.
Yeah.
Does your waiting list represent your future self or your past self?
A combo of the two. It's a combination of the two. Some of them are older members looking to retire and work. They spend it all the time. And some of them, again, are young families. So it's kind of both, because that's generally been the makeup of our club. So they go back to their friends and they come in that way. So I'm of the younger group. And so I'm saying, what's keeping me forward with getting a fledge, taking care of him, will be important in 90
I think you have a great opportunity to model where you want to be.
Yeah.
Check your future members to see if they represent a sound business model, and then move. But I guess the only shame is that you don't have data that could help you make that decision for you, right? But
it's a good observation, Peter.
Thanks, Chantel. And if you want to, please feel free to follow up, because I'm happy to talk to you more about this and help you in any way after the conference. So don't hesitate. Sometimes these are complex questions we're not going to solve in 5-minute sound clips, you know. So, but it's a good practical thing to address. Who's next? What questions do you have about what we were just showing before we got started today? Go ahead.
So one of the things on my list is to find a Uber version of the gym app down here. And there's two of them down on the trade floor. There's Gym Membership and Ziamo. Has anyone here used it? I'm curious about it.
Good question.
That's the question.
That's a good question.
Everybody? Anyone?
Yeah?
No one's heard about it. But the idea being that, you know, when you talk about the Uberization of it, right, you're basically talking about people being able to order the service and it be delivered to them, correct? Yep. Go ahead.
Hi, I have a question for the group around AI implementation. And here's my question. So AI is essentially curated content that's based on some underlying assumptions. And assumptions are sometimes misplaced and sometimes proper. And in my view, the balance between sort of the autopilot of algorithms that are assumption-based and human judgment are the open question for AI implementation. And I'd love to know what you've learned in your work, in your automations.
I think it's clear. I would be surprised to find many people here are going to know the answer to the question or give you perspective. I know Peter probably will. There'll probably be a few others, because it's a very good question. I mean, you're talking about the messy middle there. How do you implement that?
I don't know that I have the answer, but I have some experience maybe to share. So a perfect example of a machine learning environment which helps you project your future business. So where your sales will be, where your retention will be, where your churn, based on information and algorithms we run on the base data. And I think that's, in essence, very similar to AI. I think from an AI-specific perspective, I think the real challenge here is not what the data tells you and how it's used and how it's delivered. It's creating a relationship between the person that is receiving and the content. And some may do that through a persona, you know, something that you can connect to. But I think that's the real challenge there. Once we can get through that, I think we can then really make good use of the data to really support a much more interactive approach that suits the consumer rather than suits the deliverer, which is where we start with.
And also, you're probably familiar with Conversica. So some of the baselines of data as well make that a little easier, because Conversica is going through a bunch of different transactions across companies, but it still comes back, like with HubSpot's algorithm that does predictive modeling based on customers. You're probably familiar with that. But at the deeper level, I think it is hard to do what you're describing, because it takes time to understand, even with AI, what those assumptions should be, right? Because you can make mistakes.
And the assumptions may be biased. So there was an interesting comment in the New York Times yesterday or the day before, whatever, about an Amazon HR software resource, right? And it was based on past submissions of resumes that were largely resumes of men. And so the algorithm assumed that women did not qualify for the job, which created, of course, a problematic bias in not recognizing the superiority of one gender.
No, that's great. Correct. And as the presenter also showed yesterday, not completely relevant, but relevant, I think, is you showed the driverless car killing the person, right? You know, the systems, but then he shows that 1 million people a year are killed. So it's, but the bottom line, what you're saying is that, we cannot, we can't just subjugate ourselves to assumptions without challenging those assumptions, because the real sweet spot comes when you really understand what the hell's going on. That's not some machine's just telling you, to your point about understanding the personas, that you really understand that, because if you don't, you can't apply the tool well.
And you can make a lot of stupid decisions, right, that could actually harm you. So it's going to be a challenge as people apply the technology in our space. It's still new. So, but I think as time goes by, this is going to be something people want to bring up. Great question. Thank you. Who else would like to bring up a question or a challenge they're having? Don't be shy. There you go, my gentleman in the back. Please tell us who you are and where you're from.
Hi, my name's Mark. I'm from Pennsylvania. I own 3 health clubs. I've been doing this all my life. And mom and pop's operation, 10,000 square feet, pretty much each one, around 1,500 members, on a lower price point. And the $10 box club comes into our environment and makes it really difficult to, you know, we recently did a survey of our members on what they like about us, unbelievably, and this is kind of helping me. We're trying to rebrand. And rather than dictate to them, I said, well, give me 5 reasons you like our club. And the number one reason was clean. Number 2 was friendly. Number 3 was fun. So I'm trying to take that information. It had nothing to do, surprisingly to me, with what I do for a living, which is exercise classes and offer great equipment and price point, location. None of that was mentioned. So I'm here this year trying to think of, okay, well, maybe we should go where they can't go, offer some more group exercise classes or small group personal training, get involved more in HIIT. But it's a challenge because we've relied, unfortunately, live by the sword, die by the sword. We've relied a little bit too much, I think, on low price point ourselves. And now we're coming in with, and we're trying to sell. And I'm a fitness guy more than a business guy. So I try and sell the relationship piece. But I think I fostered a great relationship with a lot of members who just like to walk on the treadmill. And if you just like to walk on a treadmill, you're going to lose that. There is no relationship, right? You're going for the cheapest treadmill or the mall. So any insight is appreciated. Thank you.
Sure, Mark. So specifically your question is, how should you rethink about your strategy and your market? How long have you had the clubs?
I've been in ownership for 25 years. This brand, this is for 10 years. But it's how do you compete with a $10 price point club that's inundating our market and destroying a lot of, especially mom and pop businesses like myself?
That's a big, big question. There's been a lot published on that lately. I could speak to some of that. Anybody want to pipe in here? Yep.
So I'm in Erie, Pennsylvania, and my brother and I actually started, I don't know if you would call it backwards or forwards or what, but 9 years ago we did kind of a boutique model that did really well, and then we bought a fitness and aquatic center, and it was not doing well. It's like 30 years old. So you parked a group fitness studio at that club as a bolt-on, and it kind of reinvigorated the club again. It kind of brought new people into the parking lot. We just recently did it again at a club that was actually a really good club. And 3 months after we bought the club, Planet announced that they were going to be opening right across the street. And if we hadn't, we did another boutique model connected to the gym. And if it hadn't been for the boutique model to generate the revenue, it would have been disastrous, especially with the debt service that we had. So it's one thing to do that. It's just hard to do a conceptual kickoff in your club and then at the same time spend the money on marketing your price point. So it's like, and then you're confusing the community. Like, are you going to advertise your price point, or are you going to advertise this great new spin program you have going on inside that people can't see from the road? So our concepts you can see from the road, so it brings people in, and then you can market personal training to them and things like that. So it's just one thing that we've done that tended to work pretty good.
I know other people have done tiered pricing in a club environment like that with programming. So tier pricing for small group training, other layered programming, that's been a popular approach. Are your sites all, websites all mobilized? Have you secured all your Google business locations? Are you posting a lot of content in the community? How are you marketing?
We're getting better at it. We're trying to have a bigger social media imprint, and it's a work in progress, but it's something we can definitely improve upon.
Good. I think that's a common question lots of people have. Who else wants to pitch in or bring up another question? This gentleman here.
Like you said, I just want to say, same focus what he was talking about. So what do you suggest then as far as competing with these $10 box stores? Do you want to focus on advertising what your gym can do for the community versus on price point, because then people are going to focus more on the price, not what you actually have to offer?
It depends on the market, it depends on the business model, it depends on many factors, because not all situations are the same, right? So one of the things we covered as I went through this content is understanding your economic engine, understanding and assessing where you are, because some clubs, their rents are too high. Sometimes, you know, you have to make a decision, either renegotiate your rents given the market, or it's not going to make any sense, no matter how you slice it. In some situations, the level of competition is so high, you need to shut the business down. You know, it there's a bevy of things. In some instances, there's not adequate amount of marketing or attempt at layering alternative price options that give higher service, which are highly profitable in certain situations. In some cases, it's about shrinking footprint. So it could be, you know, a bevy of different potential things given each situation. So I can't give a broad stroke answer. And by the way, Mark, please reach out to me. I'm happy to spend time getting into more detail on this at a later point. I appreciate you bringing it up. Michael, how are you? Here you go. Tell us where you're from.
Hi, I'm Michael Cirillo. I'm from Arizona. Mark, the problem is I've had Planet Fitnesses and UFIT clubs. We've been in the $10 business for really a long time. You can't compete with them in a head-to-head type thing, yet you just have to do more. And I would say, if I was in your position, I would do more of a digital outreach to get to people before they even thought that they wanted to be a member at a club, when they're looking for information on weight loss or other types of remedial motivations, so you can start to guide their habit to come to you, to let them know that there's, you know, other things than just renting a treadmill. And that would be probably the best thing to do. Even when I used to go to new markets, I would go and tell the other club owners, don't drop your price. You know, don't do that, don't try to compete with us. Just, you know, you run your race and we run ours, and we'll likely feed your club more members eventually, because, you know, we don't have power racks. Our dumbbells don't go over 55 pounds. No group exercise. There's a lot of things we don't do that the rest of you do. And, you know, if you want to come down and compete with us, we'll kill you every time. So just stay doing what you do and let us feed you. That's because we'll eventually disappoint them. They're going to want more. And they already know there's no boogeyman at the gym once they've come to us.
Thanks, Mike. Good to see you. Appreciate you being here. Other questions? Anything on tech? Anything on business model? Anything on... Come on, listen. I'm loving the conversation so far. Yes, ma'am. Thanks for sticking your hand up. Jane, tell us where you're from.
Yeah, from Virginia. We have clubs in Texas and Nevada. Oh, sorry. We have clubs in Texas and Nevada and North Carolina. This is a little bit more on the programming side of things, but it does have to do with technology. A lot of what I am challenged with is finding whether a mobile app system or some type of software system that allows us to enroll programs, fee programs, that also integrates with Compete. Is that making sense? What I'm looking for. So if anyone could give some feedback on that, that would be very helpful.
So you're trying to integrate your booking software via mobile devices with Compete. Yeah, so they can stream it for their personal use, right?
We're also a low-cost, high-volume club, and it's very difficult to run programming and have your sales team selling it, because they're typically focused on selling memberships. So if you can find a system that we could use where they could enroll online, you know, just that as you program it, it just would help a lot. But I haven't been able to find it.
So specifically, let me make sure I got the, answering the right question. So are you saying that you're talking about just booking programming, like you're scheduling for programming? Yeah, but you pay for it on the app. Yeah, a number of vendors do that. So if you want to, I'll give you my contact information, and believe me, on the show floor, there are a number of different ecosystems. It's going to be a function, too, of just so you know, it depends on how you might be handling billing and other things and how it works. So that can be kind of a Swiss cheese of issues. So, yeah, so I'm happy to help and ask more questions because it's complicated. Like, I could ask you a dozen questions. We'd have to know, you know, a number of things. Because one of the problems that's out there, and maybe this is a good subject, and I promise to help you, so afterwards come in. One of the problems that I see is that many of these organizations, many of your businesses, they're operating 7, 8, 10 siloed systems, right? And some of those systems don't have very good APIs. And so they go to do something, and it's a pain in the butt. You know, it's like, I almost said the bad word. But does this resonate with people? Do you see this as a problem? Yeah, because, and that's why on this deck I put up there on the execution engines, enterprise platform. That's why having an enterprise platform today is so important. Because when you have a more open enterprise platform, it's easier to plug these things in versus what a lot of you deal with now, which is I've got my, you know, this solution to do this lead gen over here. I've got this billing thing over here. I've got this marketing thing over here. And you can't see the customer in a 360 view. So when it comes to data, like you were talking about, hey, who are my future customers? How am I really making money? All these things. That's where the four execution engines, that's why automation is tied to the enterprise platform. Because when you have the 360 view to the customer and all data in one spot, then you can start automating certain functions. Very hard to do that if you don't have a single platform. Anybody want to talk about what I just here? Thank you. Where are you from?
Hi, my name is Sammy. I come from Saudi. We have with Fitness Time, we have over 130 centers. I could relate to this. We have over 200,000 members in our clubs. I could very much relate to this challenge. We actually had to go over a major projects in from a billings perspective. We do have the enterprise systems where we would have to do the billing, the club management system. But obviously the challenge for us is bringing all this technology under one single system, and that is something we definitely need to do, and maybe that's why we're here today, because we want to learn how to bring in all these solutions under one single umbrella, and that is a major challenge for us. We have so much solutions out there, from access controls to our centers, to managing mobile apps, and to the client portals. These are all challenges, and we want to make sure that this is all happening under one single umbrella. For a business of over 200,000 members, trust me, this is really a major challenge for us.
Thank you. And it's an issue that we hear about all the time. I write a lot about it. I'm going to come back to you. Petra, my friend, thank you for coming.
Bryan, how are you looking to the developments of home exercising? Because there are several vendors, they are more and more focused to develop new software and to stimulate people to do their workout at home. I'm curious about your view to the future from a consumer standpoint and also from a competitive standpoint to the fitness centers.
Yes, I think this is, everyone knows the Peloton effect, right now, the Peloton effect. There are also other effects. So there's going to be the Amazon effect as well, because Alexa and other. So the Peloton effect is really the tip of the sword on a bunch of other stuff that's going to emerge. So right now you see in the retail industry in the United States, Target. So Target, a few years ago, their CFO announced that, CEO announced that they are going to have to spend $8 billion to re-engineer their business model. And the stock price really suffered. But in the last, I think it's been 6 months, the stock has rebounded tremendously. Their online sales are, I think they're growing 47%. They re-engineered their in-store experience to use their club or retail situation here as a last mile distribution point. So what Omnichannel is today, which I think this represents Omnichannel, which is basically digital experience of content and ultimately AI coaching and other health solutions, including nutrition, that can be delivered to home, is how do you integrate that into bricks and mortar? This will be the winner-take-all play, in my opinion. But it's not the only play, but it's going to be a winner-take-all play. You see this with Walmart now. So Walmart is re-engineering their business so that they are doing tremendous volume now on online. It's convenience. But the real benefit to this for our market, and I think some brands are going to get this done, is the data and the ability to monetize the interaction with the member in ways that were impossible before. And that's going to open up, I think, a whole new realm of hybrid business models that haven't existed today, to date. And I think some businesses will use technologies to stream classes directly from their clubs, which already happens. I covered several of those. There are a number of studios that are not very big that have larger revenue from their direct streaming content for working out than they do from their EFT. It's because they're very good at creating content and they've identified their audiences. And these are small companies because technology to do this is very cheap. It's getting, with OT, it's getting very cheap. So you can do that. You can truly be in Hoboken and have a bunch of users around the world because they love your training or whatever it is. So I think that will exist, but I do believe that there will be these hybrid models. You know, unfortunately, to do the hybrid model very, very well, a lot of the players are going to be large. They're going to be at scale because they can do some things. So for example, right now, Planet Fitness is developing their own platform, and you will see them, because they have 12.5 million members, begin to do things with pay through Amazon, begin to do things with content at scale, be able to do these things, because for them, given their cost structure and scale, they can do this. They can spend the money, they can play long ball and monetize the member. But then there will be other brands that do it in different ways. So I'm optimistic about it. It will cause some indigestion in the near term maybe for some people, and I understand that. But I believe that the Peloton effect is really, it's not going to overcome our industry. I think it will be subsumed by the industry. It's just another point of distribution. And the cost of the content distribution will not justify Peloton's financial existence in the next 24 to 36 months. Because the cost of what they're doing is, they shouldn't have to charge that much, honestly. And you're going to see a lot of people come in to compete with that at much lower price points, which is going to open up the whole marketplace to more of that type of thing. So where your clubs can say, hey, we'll do that too, right? So, Vincenzo. And then I'll come back to you, Peter. Great question. Thank you.
Okay, I'll come here. No, it's just chance. We are a table of Europeans, and I'm happy to be in San Diego. I don't know if my position is more there on the question or answer, because there are so many owners of fitness clubs, and basically my path starts from triathlon. I was here in San Diego 25 years ago as a triathlete and compete here because it was number one place in the world. And starting from that, I had an idea, because the first time I saw someone here just riding a bike, a bunch of triathletes in the same place. There was one here, so a Fleet Feet triathlete. I don't know if it exists anymore here in San Diego. And that was my main idea, that spinning on the earth cycling was the new fashion, because it's also involving for everyone, even great athletes, guys, girls who stay together. The same idea, then I had a fitness club, and now we have, as you know, Bryan, a company to give a new tool to clubs to stream by the place and try to have this omni-channel experience for clients. Let's say that, and I'm sure that the future, as Bryan said, is different. I mean, now there are many trades, and the low price or low cost chain is the number one. Peloton represents another senior. But I believe the Peloton is not omnichannel. And instead, any club could be a multi-channel experience for their clients, so they can have an experience in their place. And when they are not there, they need something, but they need to be in touch with their group, they belong to, their trainer. So I think that this is, I mean, I would like to know other opinions, because for sure this is a new trend and it could be a place, as you said, if you want to have business with someone who is in Singapore, in Hong Kong, for sure you have to be online. And this is something that I'm not sure if clubs are endorsing this new trend.
I think it is going to be a new trend. They already have studios doing it all over the place. So, and I think you're going to see more. But Peter, do you have something to add to that?
Actually, if you don't mind, just to go back to Sammy's question. I think we've got to the point now, actually, where it's almost impossible to have one system does everything. And I think we quickly need to embrace that, because moving outside of the facility, coping with fitness experiences, delivering them yourselves, that requires that you really know who you are and what you're trying to be for your customer. And to make good choices about the fitness experiences that you want to bring into your brand of choice position, both in and outside the facility. So really, for me, the first step is to choose a platform that is, a modern day platform that's truly open in strategy, that embraces an ecosystem of partners that will enable you to have a single source of truth, so that you can then mine into that data and understand what your populations want to do, and then invent, innovate, measure, as you move forward. You've got to get to that first step, really, before you can take the other steps that enable you to be really digitally strong and ultimately actually change your business model to compete against the inevitable low-cost environments and differentiate yourself.
Absolutely true. Let me go back to this graph, and I think this provides us more context to the talk yesterday and what you need to think about when it comes to what we're discussing. Because we're really talking about a combination of assessment, but also just to understand, when you look at the user experience dynamics that we talked about, this, which is what experience you're trying to create, which is what Peter just said, which Vincenzo was referring to, the product, the service, the experience, the moment in time, the win, and then finally, what platform, channel, in club, out club. That's the user experience design issue. You have to decide. Some of you will not be doing any streaming, and that's okay. You may have some business models that do hardcore. There's not an ounce of tech in this place, and we're not going to have any air conditioning. You're going to sweat your butt off, and it's going to be all hardcore, and that's it. And that's cool. If you can know your business model, that's cool, right? Because you might be able to make that work. There'll be a certain user experience you're not going to get elsewhere, right? But then when we're talking about platforms, Peter just talked about, that is why the execution engine focus is so critical, because you won't be able to do this without that. It'll be almost impossible. It will be, because this, if this is what you're trying to do, hey, if I know personalization in your tennis club or in your club, there are a number of cohorts. You may be serving a half dozen key cohorts, key buyers, maybe moms, it may be, whatever that you want to define those personas by. You need to know who they are, so that when they're engaging with you, they're getting what they're looking for. You're not just throwing some generic content at them. It needs to be frictionless. If they want to buy from you, don't have 10 steps to hire a trainer where you're filling out forms. That's not going to work. Strategic, you need to have video. You need to have experiences that are very strategic. It's where people's attentions are, and you need to look at omnichannel. To do that, you have to really address this. And that's why I have this up here. Because, if you don't have an enterprise platform that has an open philosophy, it's going to be very hard to do that.
So, not to belabor that point, but the notion of this enterprise platform for business management and information understanding will extend to fitness itself as a platform, encompassing medical, personal, biometrics, nutrition, fitness workout stuff at a broader level for consumers.
Yeah, Apple Health's doing that. That's what that is, and there are others. Alexa's and Amazon's working on that in concert with other organizations right now. So that's going on. So it's a matter of time.
Hi, I'm Erin Kelly from Brick Bodies. Just a quick question on the enterprise platform. I was just curious to hear if anyone in the room is using something that they're finding that is more easily integrated with all the other many platforms that we're using. So I didn't know if anyone had feedback on that.
I try not to plug vendors. So I will talk to you afterwards. But anybody else want to give their feedback on this? Yes, this gentleman, hold on.
Hi guys, Johnny from Nashville. I'm curious, one of the fundamental aspects of why we're all in the fitness business is that we make fixed asset investments that customers don't want to make. So when I look at Peloton and look at other things like that, it almost puts the consumer as deciding to get into that game, because just like when, by putting more technology into it, it makes it like the person has to buy the new cell phone every single year because there's a new asset, like new feature of it. So that's when I think about Peloton or whatever it is. Yes, they can justify the investment because the group experience they're having, but how, to me it's hard to think about there's that many people and that much run rate to be able to continue to upgrade their equipment and basically next year, hey, now there's a new 8K screen and you're not gonna get the same experience if you don't do that and basically continue to spend all that money. And so I'm curious about how that's gonna play out. Right now it's a new shiny thing.
I think you make a really good case, right? I think it may be different in general content, and I think what we're gonna see ultimately, it's not too far away, we already are seeing it, is you're gonna see behavior modification and coaching that's gonna be completely automated at disposal for people whenever they wanna consume it. So, but you're right, I think the Peloton thing is a thing. I don't think it's an extrapolation that's gonna keep climbing like this. For that and other reasons, part of their monetization model that makes them so valuable is that they're collecting $39 a month. Now, they kind of disconnected the content play from the equipment. You can get the app. So, but there are literally hundreds of competitors, let alone bricks and mortar competitors, that are going to come in with the same solution and be able to be more highly targeted. Because with your club, you literally could be streaming your content via, you know, over-the-top transmission through a variety of other platforms where, you know, and you already have the fixed cost investment, so there's a lot of things you're going to be able to do. So I agree with your thesis. I agree with your thesis. I think it is the shiny new thing. But I think it's a trend that's real. I think it's what has to do with the fact that it's the era of the customer. People are going to get what they want when they want it. So, and I think that you see Alexa now delivering this content. You know, you're going to see a lot of other platforms that are less hardware dependent. So I think it's going to be there. The thesis we have is that there will be 1 billion global users through digital or bricks and mortar in the world by within the next 4 years. The market will more than triple because of just the ease of consumption. And so it's like music. I mentioned yesterday, the music industry, the only people complaining about the music industry saying it was dead were the hogs that were just, you know, just ripping everyone off because of the market dominance. There was no barrier. They had a barrier to entry people had to overcome. Once digital came in, they removed that barrier. But now the benefit of that was that all of you are listening to music you would have never heard if that hadn't happened. And what's happening now is live concerts are up like almost 400%. Attendance is up almost 400% since 2000. The vinyl is coming back, you know, because people are really getting into music. The same thing will happen with fitness and health experiences, where, you know, they have to taste some new flavors, and then they'll go, oh, I can do this. Well, I'm going to go to your club experience, too. They may have never been your customer. So we believe in that thesis. It's just you got to go through the ebbs and flows, so to speak, with good observation. Anybody else? I'm going to come back to you, Mitchell.
I think another issue I think we can think a little bit about, because John Foley, the founder of Peloton, said that his opinion and his goal is like to do a process like that one of arcades of the 80s. Now, at that time, everybody was going to arcade to play video games, and now they almost disappeared. There are some. And this, in his opinion, I don't believe that, because it's different. The multi-channel experience is something else. But I'm sure that it's not Peloton, it's Miro, it's so many. First of all, now they are aiming to the not active paying clients of fitness club. Because if you go over the internet, YouTube, everybody are saying that it's better to buy it. It's buy it, I pay $35, I don't go there. And another very interesting data is that they say that if someone buy a Peloton, they exercise 11 times you know, 11 times a month, that it's a lot more than in a physical gym. So I'm for sure the threat is there, but the real battle could be won by a physical fitness club proposing the multi-channel experience as something else.
Yeah, I agree with your thesis. So any other, yes ma'am. Who are you, where are you from?
I'm Geraldine Cooper-Smith. I'm from outside of Portland, Oregon. I was with Nike, Equinox before that, and most recently with Flywheel, so I lived through this launch. So Flywheel was the first Peloton competitor to come into the at-home market. It was a very powerful experience to take the 42 locations that we have and then bring it out into the open where we'll never be in Sheboygan. You know, we're never, there's certain places in the country, in the world, that we're never going to be as a brand. And to have that omni-channel experience for people is really powerful. It brought way more people into what is already a very strong community. And they wanted the community. I think the fitness was a secondary thing. It was, they felt the community, it was sticky. It was welcoming, it was competitive in a friendly way, and people wanted to get more and more involved in it. So I think it's two things. One thing, I think everybody's gonna have to find some way to get, doesn't have to be high, like high production value, but I do think there has to be very good content delivered at scale in an omni-channel experience for pretty much any brand that wants to compete. And just to your point, most of the conversations that I was involved in my time at Flywheel, you know, it was less about the equipment. It's more about the Netflix model of selling that $39 a month. So I think it's the future. I don't think it's slowing down anytime soon. You know?
I completely agree with you. I think that is absolutely on point. So we're going to be wrapping up here in probably about 10 minutes. I think there's been some good conversation. As I mentioned, I'll publish this in our podcast here in the next week or so you can reflect upon it. What other stuff? Robotics. Anybody plan on using a robot to service their customers? Oh, I got a guy back here. You gonna use a robot? No.
Hey guys, Ryan from Nashville, Tennessee too. So I'm with this guy. It's going to be more of a marketing type question. We're in a huge marketing battle. Nashville's booming. We're a two-year club. We're the second downtown actual club competing with the YMCA. But kind of in your type of scale, our competition is boutiques. I mean, we're surrounded by 25 to 30 boutiques. Cheapest one's going to be $100 a month, but everybody's buying four or five at a time. You know, market tilts. It's going to change the whole model there, but right now that's what the city sees. A lot of people are old school, so they like the flyer, stuff like that. We're very much digital because our demographic is 22, 32 is probably 85% of our need. So sending a flyer, anything like that, is worthless. You know, it's going right in the trash. Our generation doesn't look at that type of thing. So is anybody out there doing anything that is seeing this type of competition, trying a new marketing approach? Because we do the geo-targeting, all that stuff through Facebook, Instagram, but just looking for other avenues that maybe somebody's reaching these other people at.
Anton, tell everybody your name, where you're from.
Hello, I'm Anton. Work for a large fitness holding. We're located headquarters in Russia, but we have core locations in the United States. So the problem that you're having is marketing, right? And I heard you're using only Facebook and Instagram.
Yeah, that's where our main.
That's where our main population of our budget is going, is towards those types of streams or digital marketing in some way. It's not, you know, a paper. It's not a physical thing that we're trying to do. But I just didn't know if somebody had a different idea. But what do you got out there? That's awesome.
Yes. So for digital marketing, well, right now, most of the marketing is digital because that's the cheapest way to get leads. And actually, a new source of marketing for gyms is YouTube, because YouTube is a larger, growing platform, and leads there cost far lower than Facebook. Facebook lead could be anywhere from, if you have an insanely good targeted audience, it would be from $5 to $8 a lead. And then for YouTube, the cost could be, with a very good targeted audience that you already have, custom audiences that you target, they could be anything as low as even $3 for boutique style fitness. So I would recommend you trying out and seeing YouTube as a marketing.
Yeah, marketing, you know, that's another thing. So, you know, to get into that, it depends so much on the organization.
we work with our own clubs and then with a lot of other organizations on this. So a lot of times what we find is that it's a combination of factors going on. People really not understanding their core audience, which it sounds like you do. You may have heard of Gary Vaynerchuk's The 180 play that he promotes. Have you heard of that? So it's in your area on Instagram. It's more of an organic strategy, but it's very effective. You want to identify probably, you know, the dollar-rated strategy. You want to probably identify non-keywords, okay? And then when those keywords, when you do your search around your club, you want to look at the 9 best posts every day. And every day, you're going to comment on those and give love. And you're going to do that every day. And then what you're going to do is you're going to find the top 20 to 50 influencers around each keyword, and you're going to find out who they are. And you're going to study them. You're going to figure out what you can do to work with them. It doesn't mean you necessarily have to pay them. It means you give them love. It means you invite them in. It means you have an event at the club, and you invite all the most influential Nashville keyword people, you know, and you have a party for them. Because what they're going to do is they're going to post a lot of stuff on your club and how cool the event is. And that works a lot of times. That's a strategy play. And I really recommend you thinking about that kind of thing. The other thing we see in advising clubs and looking at our own clubs is, you know, understanding your total marketing mix. Because even with digital right now, there are a lot of clubs still spending a lot of money on other stuff that they need to stop spending on so they can actually shift even more resources and new ways of doing things. Probably not your case, but in many cases we see that. We still have companies that they're spending a lot of money on billboards, or they're spending a lot of money on other things that really they could shift that money. Even direct mail. If you're doing direct mail, there's still some, you know, some basis for doing that in certain markets. It's how you do it too. It's having an integrated marketing strategy. The other thing we see on marketing is less a digital thing, it's more reality that we see commonly, is there's no basic marketing plan. Like, I'm talking about fundamental campaign planning. Like, you know, what are we going to be doing? And not doing too much, but knowing what we're actually going to do with a calendar for the next 4 to 6 months and planning around that. Not that you're going to have to do 100 things, but everything you do should be done well, should be integrated, should be relevant to the audience, and then you should be measuring it as it goes along in the right way so you're learning as you're doing it. That moving from planning to experimentation under mindset is an example of that. You're not going to know everything right away. Yes, sir. How are you doing, Rob?
Rob from Eugene, Oregon. I appreciate all the conversation around the enterprise software, so I'm going to bring it back to that one more time. We've talked about the challenges. We've talked about the importance of it. You've been kind enough with me also to follow up with you on that because it's a big initiative of ours down here. But my question then is any advice for actually the process to go through from here to find that right fit depending on the type of club you are, because it's such a big decision and you know, we can't afford to miss that.
Yeah, I could give you, when we talk, one of the things I'm going to do is recommend, you know, probably a book to look at, basically getting into business model canvassing and understanding your customer journey and kind of painting out the existing journey and how your systems are touching that, and then looking at a future state. So I think it's you start there in simple terms, you know, which is, hey, you know, where am I, you know, in the funnel. Where are the new customers coming in? How are they coming in? What is your website? What is your mobile presence? You know, these basic touch points in the front of the funnel. And once they come in, what are the touch points there? You know, what is the process to get the billing information? How are you, in these basic touch points, what service are you selling? Where are people buying? You go through the process of identifying that today and then you future-proof it. And that's the process. And I'll walk you through that. Anyone want to talk about that? Because that is the messy middle, as they like to say right there, is how you execute it. Anyone else want to share anything on that? Any final question that someone feels like we should have addressed that we didn't as we're wrapping up? I really appreciate everyone being here. It's awesome to see you all. We have some great questions. Thank you so much.
Anybody have any one last hurrah? Yes, sir. Let me get you the mic. Please, remind us where you're from and your name.
Manuel Vega, originally from New York. It's more of a plug-in for one of these what you were talking about. They have from 2 to 3, they're having a speaker's going to be speaking about how to use the events for marketing. So I don't know if maybe that's something you might be interested in. It's going to be from 2 to 3. And that might be something about how to use events, but I'm interested in something like that. Something I would never think about.
Events done right are a great thing to do, especially in today's Instagram world. Because if you're inviting the right people and you're giving them what they love, man, you can get a lot of splash on that. Yes, ma'am. Chantel.
So to add to the events piece, one of the things we do at our club is we build in a lot of our costs into our membership dues. Again, we're very different than all of you guys. But I'm more interested in providing a service. So our events are more about building community, not necessarily about us making money off of them. So one of the things we do is if a member comes to an event and they take a picture and they post on Instagram and they tag us, we waive their fee for the event. So it's one way for us to kind of reach out to their friends and for them to be like, hey, the cool place to be on Friday was Edgebrook having some wine and whatever else. And the cost of that, I mean, the cost of our events are very low. They're $4 to $8 to come to an event. So we're not really losing a whole lot, but we've created this sense. So I think that for you guys to utilize some of your social media pieces with that, you sort of talk about what the pricing was, figure out what that is, and then determine how much of a discount maybe you can give, and then determine which events you want to use that for.
Yeah, good advice. Very good advice. So just to remember, IHRSA is a International Health Records Association, of course, is a membership organization. So the organization is you. So what's great is that, you know, being at this event is we have a lot of resources. I sit on the board of the organization. I represent you. So use the resources. Feel free to reach out to me. And if I don't know an answer, I'll connect you with somebody that does. I want to give you all a round of applause for being here. Thank you so much for your great questions. And for your patience and patience for being here. Thank you so much.
Hello, listeners. This is Bryan O'Rourke, and thanks so much for listening to the Fitness Plus Technology Podcast. The podcast is made possible by the Fitness Industry Technology Council, a consortium of global brands working together to enhance the adoption of technologies in the fitness space. Our company, Videri Ventures, which is invested in Vertimax, Montezumo, Gold's Gym Houston, Texas, and Fitness 24/7 Thailand, also underwrites the podcast, along with our service companies, Integris Advisors, Moon Mission Media, and others. Please feel free to share this podcast with your colleagues. And if I can be of any assistance to you, don't hesitate to reach out, BryanK.O'Rourke@gmail.com, or find me on any of the major social networks. Have a great day, and thanks for listening.